My name is David Adam and I have Obsessive Compulsive Disorder, OCD. I want to find out more about my condition, so I've come to the University of Cambridge to find out how some of the top scientists in the field are studying this disorder and why, sometimes controversially, this involves the use of animals.
As our understanding of specific pathways in the brain increases, it's our contention that there are specific pathways that go slightly wrong in OCD, and those brain areas correspond to the same brain areas that we studied in experimental animals and shown the same symptoms of rigidity and thought using the same tests. But the difference is, in the experimental animal, we're able to understand the mechanisms by which this rigidity occurs, which we can't in humans, because we can't use interventional techniques to test the causality of the involvement of that area in thinking or behaviour.
So that's the theory, but what does research with animals actually look like? Well, it can be a bit difficult to find out because institutions like this usually keep this work pretty secret. But actually, Trevor Robbins has arranged for me to see some of it for myself. So we're going to see research with humans, we're going to look at brain scans, and we're going to look at was probably among the most controversial work with marmosets. But we're going to start with a staple of research with animals. We're going to look at studies for OCD involving the laboratory rat.
So these rats are part of a study looking at checking behaviour, and we're interested in the circuits of the brain that control checking behaviour. We use surgical techniques to just inactivate part of their frontal cortex, and through our studies of checking behaviour we can see that this rat who has this part of his frontal cortex inactivated shows a higher level of checking behaviour than we would normally expect.
Okay, so you've put the rat in
Yes.
to do this experiment, but we thought we'd leave it to do its thing and look at footage of one that you filmed earlier.
Yes.
So just describe what we're looking at here.
So this is a picture of the inside of our test box, and you can see on the right hand side there are two levers. When the rats are training on this test, then we show them a light above the lever that is the correct one to press. And they learn that very quickly. They learn to associate that light with the food reward. Now, when we're looking at their checking behaviour, we take that light away. And instead, we give them a lever at the back of the box. So this lever on the left-hand side is a lever that they can press to give them access to the light above the correct lever to press.
So it puts it on. Yes. So they press one lever to show which lever to press to get the food.
Yes, so they can effectively check on this lever at the back of the box for information about where to go next. But then sometimes they just return back again and again and keep checking to see if that light is turned on or off.
Right, and do the rats with the changes in the brain then do that more?
Yes, so the rats we've just seen with disruption to the circuits in the brain that we think are involved in OCD show much higher levels of checking behaviour than we would expect. And this is an indicator that perhaps that part of the brain is somehow controlling checking behaviour.
Right. And in this case, the checking is a complete waste of their time, because if they were to go and depress the lever, they'd get the food.
It's a waste of time. It takes them away from the part of the task that's actually useful for them, which is
eating.
Because eating.
The more time they spend Yes. checking, the less time they get to
That's right.
Eat.
Yes.
But of course, rats are quite different to humans. So Angela Roberts, Professor of Behavioural Neuroscience, has offered to show me what we can learn from studying a closer relative of ours, the marmoset. So, I've just been to see Dawn, and we met her rats. But I understand you are working with a different animal. Can you tell me about that?
Yes, so we're working with a new world monkey called the common marmoset. And we're using the marmoset because whilst the rodent brain in some ways is very similar to that of humans, the primate brain has the much more closer resemblance to human brain. And when you're studying these kinds of complex human behaviours, then ultimately at some point you need to study a brain that's a lot more similar to the human than a rodent.
So even though Dawn told me then that the mouse brain is similar enough to a human brain, was that is that not enough information? I mean, why do you need to do it with a different...
So we've gained a considerable amount of knowledge from studying the rat brain. But ultimately, if you compare a rat brain with the human brain, the most important part of the brain for information processing is something called the cortex, which sort of overlies the sort of deeper structures of the brain. And that cortex in a rat probably makes up about 28% of a rat brain. A human brain, the cortex makes up 80% of the size of the brain. And then in monkeys, it's sort of somewhere around about 60 to 70, depending on the species. So there's far more information processing going on in the cortex of a monkey compared to a rodent. And given that highly complex behaviours in humans are ultimately being controlled by that information processing going on in the cortex, that's why somewhere along the line you need to be able to do some of these studies in monkeys.
Now, using primates in science is about as controversial as it gets. I've met many even fully committed scientists who don't think we should be doing it. So why should we?
Well, I mean, the answer to that ultimately comes in the suffering that you see in patients with, in the case of what we're studying, neuropsychiatric disorders. 60% of patients can't be successfully treated very effectively with the current therapies, whether that's cognitive behavioural therapy or drugs, pharmacotherapies. And we really do need to generate a much better understanding of the kinds of brain circuits that are involved in controlling these complex behaviours in order for us to actually generate the new generation of drugs or therapies. And in order to do that, we have to turn to animals, and we have to turn at some level to a primate, which has got the complex brain that you see in a human. And ultimately, it's about weighing a balance. And we all have to make that decision about what we feel comfortable about working with, but you're having to balance the studies we're doing in primates versus the kinds of suffering that humans are under with some of these disorders, which can be debilitating. And for years they've been on one drug therapy or another one, and it hasn't worked, along with all the side effects that go with taking drugs. And so ultimately you're weighing up, well, should we let this person continue suffering, or should we do careful, controlled, restricted studies in animals that we think are really important, and particularly in primates?
But why can't we just do that work with humans? So I have OCD, why can't you just look at my brain and try and work out how those treatments might be developed?
Well, we've gleaned lots of information about looking at your brain and other people's brains with regard to some of these disorders. And we get a lot of information about what areas of the brain are more active or what areas of the brain are less active compared to someone which doesn't have that disorder. But the problem with that is ultimately the information's correlation. And what you don't know is whether those changes that you're seeing, are they actually causal to some of the symptoms you're experiencing, or are they, for example, compensatory? So is this bit of the brain that we're seeing is more active? Is it actually more active and causing your problems, or actually is it just trying to compensate not very well for the problems that you're experiencing? And you can't address that causal question with a human. That's where you have to go to an animal, because then in an animal, if we've got those two changes in activity, we can actually make those changes in an animal. We can overactivate one bit of the brain, we can underactivate another bit, and look to see which one of those potentially produces a behaviour that's similar to a behaviour you're experiencing. So what I'm going to show you here is a marmoset performing a particular task that we have been using, which is quite useful for trying to understand some of the repetitive behaviours that you see in OCD sufferers. This particular marmoset, you can see there are these little metal tubes just coming out of his head here. And that's because we've implanted effectively what they call cannulae. In a one-off surgical operation, we implant these cannulae into the brain of the marmosets, allowing us to target a particular brain region. This is a special surgical cement that just keeps these cannulae in place.
It sounds quite extreme. So the monkey lives with these two tubes? in its brain. Does it bother it?
No, they don't. It doesn't seem to bother them at all. And their partners don't seem to mind them, take no notice of them. Sometimes some of the partners will groom it, so they'll find them grooming all around the area. And the marmoset who's got the cannulae sort of sits there enjoying his grooming from his partner. So no, they don't seem to be bothered by it at all once it's in place.
So this, an image of a monkey with tubes coming into its brain, is about as severe as it gets probably for people. And those are the kind of images that are used to try and counter animal research. Would you do that sort of thing in a human?
Well, yes, I mean, when you do some of the surgical treatments for example, Parkinson's disease and for OCD, deep brain stimulation, you are having to insert devices into the brain.
As electrodes, aren't they? They go
exactly,
right down
yes.
into the
brain. In order to be able to perform these treatments. So in that sense, it's what's being done in patients as well. But of course, here we're using it to ask the experimental questions of when we sort of temporarily activate a particular part of the brain, what are the effects on that? And the reason that's a really important question to ask and sort of builds on the research we've done before. In the past, we tended to make permanent lesions. So you'd destroy a small localized region of cell bodies and look at the effects of that in order to try and localize where some of these deficits are coming from. But now the approach we've sort of developed over the years is that you can actually inactivate these areas temporarily. So by having these cannulae placed permanently in the brain, you can infuse drugs down them, which will just act for the short period of time that they are around, and in which case it may be to inactivate an area or to activate an area, depending on what we're trying to mimic that's seen in patients. But then once the drug's worn off, 20 minutes, half an hour afterwards, perhaps 45 minutes afterwards, then that part of the brain goes back to working normally again. In this task then, so what the marmosets are doing, they're being presented with two coloured stimuli on the screen, and they've learned, actually from the previous day, that this red and yellow one is rewarded if they respond to it, whereas this other blue flower isn't rewarded if they respond to it. And so as you can see, this animal knows that, he's in the apparatus happily pressing away the red and yellow stimulus, and every time he responds on it, there's a little twittery sound which comes on telling him juice is available, and then he's licking away at the banana juice to get his reward. But the interesting part of this is that suddenly, halfway through this session, we're going to change the relationship between the stimuli and the reward. So having been responding to the yellow and red stimulus for so long, getting reward, here we go.
He's actually a bit confused.
Yeah,
now.
He's got it wrong. So that's kind of put him off a little bit, and he does it again because this has always been rewarded and suddenly it isn't. So an animal normally will make a few of those repetitive behaviours to the wrong stimulus, getting it wrong, but then he'll obviously start thinking, well, I better do something else. So then he ends up touching the other stimulus, and you'll see eventually he does start to touch the other stimulus. He's just done it there, the flower.
Right.
He's got his reward.
Okay.
So now we can start realising and learning, oh, it's this other stimulus now that's rewarded. What's interesting about this task is that, firstly, quite a few years ago now, we showed that a particular part of the prefrontal cortex, the orbital frontal cortex, which is just above the orbits, hence its name, if you inactivate that bit of the orbital frontal cortex, it causes animals to be more repetitive in their behaviour. So it doesn't stop them learning this discrimination. They're happy to learn that the yellow and red stimulus is rewarded. But when suddenly, halfway through the task, the relationship has changed, they find it very difficult to change their behaviour, and so they're stickier. They just carry on responding to the stimulus that was rewarded but actually isn't rewarded anymore, and they're no longer getting reward for it, but they take much longer to switch. And this task is quite interesting because it's been used in patients with OCD, and some patients with OCD you see very marked changes within the orbitofrontal cortex, the very area we know is important for this task, for switching in this task. We see changes in activity in the area of the brains of patients with OCD when they're performing this task. We even see it in first degree relatives. And so we're very interested in trying to understand the circuit involved in this kind of behaviour, because it may give us some insight into ultimately the development of compulsions. But so this is just one example of a test that we've been using, because it does seem to have quite a lot of applicability given the effects we've been seeing in OCD patients and also the relationship with the drugs they're taking.
In the next film, I find out how this work in rats and marmosets relates to what we know about the human brain. And what better way than to look inside my own brain?